Cog. Look.
When I was a kid, I loved trees. I'd swing from their branches. My friends and I would climb way up away from the adults to whisper secrets. Little did we know the tree might have been storing the carbon dioxide we exhaled along with our secrets. That's because trees are carbon sinks. They hold on to carbon. But to understand how the trees store carbon, we'll have to explore those amazing plant, algae, and some bacteria with a superpower we call photosynthesis. Photo means light, and synthesis means making something. What are they making? To answer that, we can start by comparing this toddler and this cottonwood seedling. They're both small, and they're both going to grow a lot. The toddler gets water from a sippy cup. The seedling sucks liquid water up through its roots and takes up water vapor through pores in its leaves. The toddler gets carbs, proteins, and fats from food, and voila, a full-grown human. But what about the seedling? It grows into this big, gorgeous tree. But what did it eat to do that? That's what Jan Baptista Van Helmont wondered in 1639. He weighed a willow sapling and then planted it in a pot of dry soil or dirt. The sapling weighed 5 pounds, or 2.2 kilograms. The dry soil weighed 200 pounds, or 90 kilograms. For 5 years, he added only water to the tree. At the end of 5 years, he pulled the tree, dried it, and weighed it. The tree weighed 169 pounds, or 77 kilograms. But the dried soil had lost only 2 ounces, 57 grams. That's 164 pounds of wood, bark, and roots that wasn't from the soil. So where did it come from? Van Helmont guessed it came from the water. But he didn't know what we know. Water is made of just hydrogen and oxygen. And that's not enough to make the snazzy solids we find in trees. So if it wasn't the soil and it wasn't water, could the 164 pounds have come from sunlight? Well, the sun's energy is held in the bonds of a tree's carbohydrates, fats, proteins, and DNA. But molecules are matter, not pure energy. So where did that mass come from? If only we could shrink down to fit inside a plant cell. Oh, look, Cog. This plant cell has a cell membrane and a cell wall to protect it, a nucleus for DNA, a vacuole that primarily holds water. There's a mitochondrion that generates energy for the cell, and some chloroplasts. Hey, cool chef's hat. And you've even got a recipe book. First, you gotta find an easy-bake sunlight oven, technically called a chloroplast. They're easy to find because the chlorophyll makes them green. Now add water molecules. Well, that was easy. Mix in some carbon dioxide molecules. CO2 enters the cell through pores in their leaves, so there's plenty of them. Now all we need is sunlight and wow! Hey, look at those oxygen molecules leaving the cell. That's waste for the cell. They're going to keep moving until they escape through pores in the leaf, and we can breathe them in. Oh my goodness, what is this? It's amazing. It's a free glucose molecule, a simple sugar. It's food for the cell. Congratulations, Cog. You're ready for the next recipe in your photosynthesis cookbook. So let's take a look at that book right now. You know, we used to think glucose was the final product of photosynthesis. Now we know that those chloroplasts are turning glucose into sucrose by attaching a fructose molecule. A little too much information? Well, let's just say that the chloroplasts are making simple sugars that are food molecules, and the plant cell uses that food two different ways. One way the cell uses those sugars is to get energy. It's a neat little system where photosynthesis captures the sun's energy and puts it into the bonds that hold those sugars together. Then, cellular respiration, which we explored in episode 2, uses oxygen to break apart those sugars, releasing the sun's energy and turning it into chemical energy the cell can use. In the process, it creates carbon dioxide and water. Don't be surprised that plants release some CO2 when they're breaking down food. I mean, they need energy too. But wait, there's more to this story. Let's turn the page of Cog's recipe book and see the second way those sugars are being used. Outside the chloroplast, the cell breaks down those sugars and reassembles them into complex carbs, fats, proteins, and some genetic material, all the stuff life is made of. The chloroplast makes sugars that are food molecules. The cell breaks down those sugars and uses the pieces to build the tree. Now we know where that 164 pounds of Van Helmont's tree came from. Photosynthesis used carbon dioxide and water to make food that made the tree. If we could separate out the atoms in Van Helmont's dried tree and weigh them separately, we'd find about 50% of its mass is carbon and 42% is oxygen. Studies have shown that this oxygen came from the carbon dioxide. That means 92% of the tree's mass came from carbon dioxide, gas, in the air. Although the tree has lots of hydrogens from water, each one is very light, so they're only 6% of its mass. Elements like nitrogen and phosphorus are crucial to making proteins and genetic material, but they're only 2% of the tree's mass. Let's not leaf this topic until we've done a geometry activity. We're going to find the approximate biomass of this cottonwood tree and estimate how much of it came from carbon dioxide gas. To find the tree's approximate height, I'll measure the length of the shadow cast by a meter stick. At this time of day, 1 meter of height equals 1.1 meter of shadow. My tree's shadow is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, and more. Let's call it 16 and a half meters. Solve the proportion. And my tree is 15 meters tall. Now I'm going to pretend the tree's trunk and its branches fit into a cylinder shape, rising from the ground. We're going to ignore the roots. To find the volume of the visible tree, we're going to have to find the diameter and the radius first. It looks like the diameter of my tree is about 0.5 meters, so the radius is about 0.25 meters. To find the volume of that tree cylinder, we multiply the area of the base times the height. So our very rough estimate for the volume is about 3 cubic meters. Cottonwood has about 410 kilograms of mass per cubic meter. So 3 cubic meters of cottonwood tree has a mass of 1,230 kilograms. Now, had we used the shortcut method, we would have used this graph and the diameter of 50 centimeters to see that the tree has a mass of about 1,300 kilograms. But only 92% of it comes from carbon and oxygen in the air. Either way, you figure out the mass. When we're looking at this tree, we're looking at over a ton of mass from carbon dioxide. I mean, it literally came out of thin air. Pretty tremendous, if you ask me. But let's recap. What does a plant eat to grow? The mass of a plant, a tree for example, is not primarily from soil, water, or sunlight. Photosynthetic cells use carbon dioxide and water to produce sugars, food molecules. Those sugars provide energy to the cell during cellular respiration. And those sugars are also broken into pieces and reused to make carbs, fats, proteins, and some genetic material. When you're looking at a tree, its mass is mostly from carbon dioxide gas. Well, in this episode, we got to the root of carbon sinks by looking at trees. In our next episode, we'll look at a different photosynthetic superhero, algae, and some carbon sinks that really take a plunge.